Yeah, don't you stay in the sun.
Afternoon.
Thanks, Mr. Fields.
Frank, we're ready. Frank, how?
Hi.
Well.
Good afternoon, Mr. President.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good to see you.
Appreciate you having me over and formally congratulations. I feel like I just won the World Series and get a call from the president or something like that.
Well, now, shall we get over and.
Sure.
Whatever you'd like. I thought maybe this kind of like we're working.
Oh, yeah, that'd be great. That'd be great. Got a couple of things. Well, they just did a poll out in Nebraska. You're 60% voter approval. I don't know how Nebraska rates with the rest of the states around the country, but they're still very popular out there.
That sounds good.
And more popular than our governor, unfortunately, okay, where she's a little bit below 50%. So if you want to run for governor, maybe you might want.
Now, you've got a race against the next governor, I think.
Right, right. And it's going to be a good race, but it's a race we should win. It's a Republican state, popular president, 50. Yeah, yeah.
We need to, we could have taken five more, and we'll have a majority again.
Well, I think we can do it, and it's, Nebraska's going to be a key. It's going to be a key.
Just a few little exceptions there. The enemy's in.
Yeah.
Both houses of the West.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Well, a couple thousand on your schedule. I've talked to your people. As you know, you're going to be in Nebraska in September, I think, for Bob Gray's Communication Center dedication in Hastings, Nebraska. And I would like to do something in conjunction with your visit out there. And I've mentioned that. And also maybe doing something here in Washington. We're going to have to raise some money, spend quite a bit of money in the primary.
But yeah,
in a way,
I don't see what we should enforce.
You don't really want to rush it for
life. I'll just go out and say something. Hello. Hello. Good to see you. Hello.
Nice to see you.
And my favorite poet. Hello there. It's nice to see you.
Thank you.
Anyone who can write a full letter with 10 signatures on it on a piece of paper that is 1/2 inch by 4 inches long. That's what she did. And I have her letter. Well, it's good to see you again.
How are you, Mr. President? Yeah. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Mr. President?
Yeah. Nice to see you. Hi.
Hello, President.
Well, welcome. And I'm pleased to see some old friends here in the Roosevelt Room. I guess it's been a good year and a half since I last spoke with you, Yuri. And I'll never forget the beautiful poem you gave me, Irina, that you had written in the Gulag. And of course, I'm happy to meet a number of you for the first time. As we have in every previous meeting, we'll discuss vital issues in four broad areas, as I've done in every previous meeting. I'll make sure human rights is at the top of the agenda. We're far from satisfied with Soviet human rights performance. In all honesty, I have to say there has been an improvement over the past 2 years. It started when Andrei Sakharov was finally permitted to return from exile. But it seems every time the Soviets take 2 steps forward, they take 1 step backward. And if I'm correct, that's what Lenin said way back in the beginning, they continue to do. But in recent months, they've begun breaking up peaceful demonstrations, especially where national minority groups are involved. And they also began arresting people for anti-Soviet agitation. There's still several hundred prisoners, especially prisoners of faith, in the labor camps. And while they've said a lot about reforming some of their unjust laws, so far it's only been talk. And now I'd like to hear from you about the most pressing concerns as I prepare to leave for Moscow.
Thank you, Mr. President. Time is short, and I know each of your guests would like to say a word or two, so why don't we begin with Josh Rubenstein and have a stand.
tight as possible.
Except I think I should get out and tell you that they tagged me limited service because of my vision, and I wound up flying a desk on the airport. I never cracked that glass.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's a great honor. Thank you to have you all here. We've been busy for a few days, right?
Yes, sir, we are. We are. We're looking forward to Wednesday, maybe October, also.
That's what I've also heard. We'll be waiting.
Great. We won't surprise you as well. Well, maybe we will.
Be looking forward to it.
All right, boss. Do you have something here for you? Sure, Nancy's got a wall big enough for this or not.
I tell you where I'll bet it will go. It's gonna be a presidential library.
Oh, great. This is, we got a little bit of everything. This is our crest. Here's the picture. This is Pensacola, USS Lexington, that we trained all the aviators on. Thousands of aviators have been trained on a particular carrier, including one 22 years ago, which was me. And these are the formation, this is a solo shot here, and this is our Fat Albert here. We met their pilots today. And this is the, all the years, the different airplanes, all the way from the Hellcat up to the Hornets. The Hornets, all the way through here. That's, we're in our 42nd year now, which is, I might add, quite a bit longer than the Thunderbirds.
These two are running into each other?
Oh, no, I was just giving the crowd a thrill.
I'm a lot shorter than you.
Well, I'm very pleased about it. Thank you very much. Yes, some souvenir carriers visit here. Must have some need for keys sometimes.
Oh, yes, sir.
These are key rings with the seal.
Thank you very much. So we have something here also that's kind of conditioned that we pin our girlfriends and wives and ladies. So for Nancy, we have here.
Pinned her once with my fraternity pin, but we kind of outgrown that. Well, thank you very much. She will too.
So are you looking forward to going to Russia?
In one way, yes. Curiosity and so forth, some things to be done. In another, from all that I've heard of everybody that has gone there to visit, everyone tells me how happy they are to leave. I think there's going to be a lot to talk about there. He and I get some pretty good arguments.
What kind of guy is Mr. Gorbachev, sir?
Well, the funny thing is, he's totally different than any of the other leaders that I've ever met. And you have a feeling, yeah, we can get points and finger at each other in one-on-one conversations, but it's just business there. And there or not, I think there's actually a kind of a rapport that's been established. And got a good sense of humor. Sometimes, in our arguments, he's young enough that he's spent his entire life in communism. So he believes their propaganda about us, that we take orders from the military-industrial complex and so forth. Hardly one day about he and I, and when he's here, in this last meeting, about human rights and so forth. And
yeah, but he says, what about that border, that fence on the Mexican border? I said, well, there's a difference between having a fence to keep someone out and a fence to keep someone in. I didn't have the nerve to tell him the story that has come to me about Honecker and East Germany, about tearing down the wall. Seems he met a young lady, and he was quite taken. She said, tear down the wall. And he said, tear down the wall? Oh, he says, I know. You want to be alone with me. you probably are aware that there are an awful lot of jokes now that are told by the Russians among themselves about their system there. And I've been making a collection of those. Definitely from there, and their stories. And I told a couple of them to him. There's a few I won't tell. One of the most recent was that an order has gone out that anyone caught speeding, no matter who, gets a ticket. Because, you know, most of the driving is done by the bureaucrats, their drivers and all. And the story is that Gorbachev came out of his country home, and he gave his driver was waiting there with the car, and he knew he was late, and he saw the driver get in the back seat. He says, I'll drive it. Down the road he went, passed two motorcycle policemen. One of them took out after him. Just a few minutes, he's back with his buddy, and the buddy said, well, did you give him a ticket? He said, no. Well, he said, we're told to give anyone a ticket over to wounded. He says, no, not this one. He was too important. Well, he said, who was it? He said, I couldn't recognize him, but his driver was Gorbachev. But this one is the American and the Russian are arguing about our two countries. The American said, look, I can go into the Oval Office. I can pound the president's desk and I can say, Mr. President, I don't like the way you're running our country. And the Russian said, I can do that. The American said, you can? He says, I can go to the Kremlin and the General Secretary's office, pound his desk and say, Mr. General Secretary, I don't like the way President Reagan's running this country.
By telling the one about the curfew.
Oh, well, this is one I thought would be tactless to tell him. And this is a man walking down the street in the evening. Moscow soldier yelled halt. The man started to run. The soldier shot him. And another Russian saw this and says, why did you do that? And he said, curfew. And he said, well, it isn't curfew yet. He says, I know. He's a friend of mine. I know where he lives. He couldn't have made it. Well, listen, it's been a great pleasure to see you all, have you all in here. You know this is the Roosevelt Room, and that's the Nobel Prize that he got for making peace between Russia and the Japanese in the Russo-Japanese War. And when I get the proper news, I know that I shouldn't be partisan, all I like to tell you, which is not nice, I like to point out that Roosevelt did that in typical Republican style. He was sitting on a yacht and they agreed.
Sounds good enough for me.
All right, well,
thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Join us.